Good afternoon, everyone. This is Michael with Premier Power. I wasn't expecting that here. Thank you for joining the show. This is the half hour of Premier Power, as I call it. I've got a couple guests with me today. We're going to be talking about surge protection. The first guest I have again, and his voice is familiar, is my father, Mike. Want to say hi to the audience?
How you guys doing? Glad to be back again this weekend, son.
All right. We've also got Mark with SciComm Surge Protector. He is the founder, owner of Surge Protection, which is a distributor and a manufacturer company. Mark, want to introduce yourself to the audience?
Yes, my name is Mark Tucker. I'm from Clearwater, Florida, and surge protection has been in my blood for 30 years.
Surge protection, surge, bloods kind of freaks me out a little bit. When I first hear surge protection, I hear lightning. So we're going to be talking about it. You know, what are the effects? What should we have? What does it do? Dad, do you have a couple points you want to bring up or anything here?
Yeah, I think I'll go ahead and lead this on the safety aspects. And then, Marcus, we're just talking in there. You feel the need that you can go ahead and contribute something in there.
Yes, another thing, surge protection, safety, insurance, all things that I come up based on my experience and everything. I'm not an expert in it, but that's why we have Mark. You have my father. So,
all right, yeah, we're going to try to give you as much information as possible, but keep in mind when it comes to insurance, we might be saying something and it might be totally wrong. So we're going to be very, very careful what we say when we come in this particular area here. All right, surge protection. More than likely, most people probably listening to the radio show has probably heard that term. Mm-hmm. We live in Florida. And we're near Central Florida. We're near Clearwater. I think Clearwater is the lightning capital of the United States. And we're just a little bit, probably about 100 miles or maybe less than that away from that area there. So in Lake County, there's a lot of issues having to do with lightning. Not lately because we haven't had any rains, but pretty soon that should be coming back, hopefully one day. And what happens is, son, is that people have a lot of electronic equipment. Today, you can get dryers with a lot of electronics. As a matter of fact, and my wife, we are in a practice of making sure that when we buy anything for a home, given an opportunity, we will not choose electronic. In other words, if we get a washing machine, we bought a new washing machine and a new dryer. We don't want anything with electronics.
I'm wondering why your house isn't as smart and advanced. You're building a house.
Yep,
right now. So you are these simple. I don't know if you know my father. He's simple. He's straight to the point. Solve the problem. That's it. So I'm wondering now. Why you don't
do because when you have electronics,
it's more prone to damage.
What's going to happen is when you have lightning strikes. Oh, give us some of the different examples of what causes surges, and we'll talk more about surge protection. But a little bit there, Mark, tell us what you know about what causes surges and where they might come from.
Lightning, of course, being the most catastrophic of them. But you have cars hitting poles creates a surge. You have rodents getting into the wiring, getting into your stack at your home, anywhere in the system, trees in the wind rubbing on power lines, anything at all that will get two wires to touch together is going to induce a surge.
So it creates like a spike, so yes. A high inrush yep. voltage source. Right?
You know, I talked to there's another one, Mark, and I hate to interrupt you guys here, but another one is that simply loads turning on and off in your home. An air conditioner, when it comes on, son, I think you probably notice in your house, if you have incandescent lighting, you'll see an air conditioner kicks on, the lights dim for a moment. Do you have that problem in your house? And then the lights come back up.
You know, actually, I don't believe I have that problem.
Okay, in your case, you might not have incandescent light bulbs, but if your lights dim when the air conditioner kicks on or where a motor comes on or a refrigerator comes on, you know, an example is I had a situation where Autumn, she had her lights coming bright and dim because of the iron. The iron was kicking on and kicking off. So anytime loads are coming on and causing the lights to dim, and you want to tell us a little about that, Mark, and when the lights go down, there has to be some balance taking place here.
For it's just like water in that for every low, there is absolutely an equal high, and that high is a surge.
So when the loads start, the lights dim, which means there's less power. You follow the concept there? Mm-hmm. Then all of a sudden, the loads kind of switch into a different state. And then what happens is that energy that was being pulled down all of a sudden gets like a spring, it gets released. So there's like a little micro burst of energy. It's not like a lightning strike, which is this tremendous amount of power. It's just this little burst of energy. And what happens is electronics, if you can visualize it, because of the transistor and because of the technologies of photography and the way they now can make wafers by molecule thickness, the separation between electrical parts in an electronic equipment is very, very small. Mm-hmm. So you have currents leaving, let's say, traveling in a certain path, and then you got something that's close to it. Well, when you get this surge, those electrons can't make those turns. And all of a sudden, that surge pushes. So it's like a 22 bullet of energy going into an electronic piece of equipment. It can't turn. So it's the surge of energy that's this sudden pressure. It's like having water in your house, and something happens outside, and there's this major pressure of water coming in. That's why houses have pressure relief valves. Your water heater has a pressure relief valve. It's an overflow. So when the pressure gets too big, it kind of bypasses the energy, and it takes it away. So you have energy that's being transmitted at high speeds for very short durations, but electronic equipment was supposed to be 120 volts, 60 hertz, everything traveling at that speed. Now you have this high speed, lightning and all these other causes of the energy. So now, what happens there, Mark? So we got this energy that is always going on. And see, son, we didn't have this problem 30 years ago when we didn't have electronic equipment. Mm. It's today when you buy a TV and you buy electronic DVDs, players, and in your house, everything is electronic.
And everybody's even going further into it because everybody loves technology and the advancements and the convenience that they create.
Yeah, the old days was easy. Tube got bright, tube got dim.
Yeah.
It was an old TV.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, yeah. So the TVs. Yeah. So today, with the amount of electronic equipment, and because we are in an area that has a lot of lightning, and you have the natural tendency of loads turning on and off, so you get the brightness and the dimness. And so now what you have is you have all this stuff that slowly the electronics, and you used, as we got earlier, Mark, you used the word degradation. Tell us.
Yeah, degradation of your equipment is occurring all the time when you're getting peppered with these little tiny surges. It's making your, let's say, 100% efficient fridge become 80% efficient over a period of time because it's getting peppered with little tiny power surges.
Well, we won't. I'm not sure. We won't go to that one there. But I'm looking more in the electronics, not loads like that. And the electronics, and I like the word peppered, as you get these little spikes,
yeah.
What it does is it starts just kind of etching those electronic wiring paths. Michael, do you follow what I'm saying? In other words, you have thin, little, tiny things, and these little peppered spikes just keep degrading, and so it starts reducing the value of that electronic. And then all of a sudden, one day, it could be a simple little thing. You just simply turn on the air conditioner, and then boom, hey, the TV doesn't work. You don't know that the TV was working an instant before. All you know is that when you go to turn on the remote, the TV doesn't work. Some other electric dryer doesn't work. You know, the stove, there's so many electronics. So that's the concern, is if you have any kind of electronics in your home, you need to protect them because ultimately the surges from lightning and other causes are going to deteriorate, degrade those electronics, and then there's a failure.
Okay. So surge comes in here. Now, that's where surge we're introducing to the protection. So Mark, tell me more, a little bit more about what does that do and how does that prevent it? Or
and we're not going to try it. We're not going to get into the technical aspects. But why don't you tell people to give us a call?
If you have any questions or concerns, please feel free to give us a call at My790AM. The number is 352-787-9523. Or you can visit us on the web on my website, premierpowerinc.com. Or you can even send me a message or phone me at 352-978-7015. And please, we encourage you to call us and visit with us and give us some feedback here. We'd love to help.
Well, you know, Michael, you have a great website, premierpowerinc.com. And there is a tab that says important information. And in that tab, when you get the important information, there is also a section on surge protection. So some people are really kind of techie and they want to get more information as to what's going on. And so we're just going to try to cover the surface, some basic information for a homeowner or a commercial property owner to have some information. Okay, Mark, I'm sorry. We wanted to get us into what does these – you designed these things, and you've been – it's your company for 18 years. Have you changed your product, and by the way, or is it when you guys did 18 years ago it was perfect?
No. There has been changes, and there is ongoing changes. And the biggest reason for that is the equipment out there in the homes has changed over the years. It's become more and more sensitive. We started out, I can tell you, 18 years ago, clamping or turning our product on at 400 and 500 volts, and it didn't damage equipment. You can't do that today. We have to turn on now at 150 because everything has become so much more sensitive. The technology is so much more advanced.
You mean the introduction to the more advanced equipment that we have, the computer,
yes.
The iPhones, the iPads, yeah. The TVs.
I'll mention this, and I don't want to get techie. You mentioned that it clamps. at 400 to 500 volts years ago, and now it clamps 150. For those listening, what it means is right now in your house it's 120 volts. So you have a TV connected to 120 volts. It's for some crazy reason, a lightning strike, a telephone pole got hit by a car, a load turned on. It all created this impulse of energy that was more than 120 volts. What your device does is it does what? It diverts the energy and it absorbs that energy.
It diverts the energy to ground. The analogy you made of a pressure valve on that heater, hot water tank, is exactly what happens. A surge protector is a pressure valve on the electrical system.
I'm going to hold off here for a minute. We get a little break here. We'll be back after a couple of minutes, and we'll see you in a couple. Oh, if you have any questions or concerns, feel free to give us a call. My790AM, 787-9523. Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Back to the half hour of Premier Power. I'm accompanied by my father, Mike Holt, electrical expert, and Mark with SciComp. Mark, what's your last name again? I'm
sorry. Tucker.
Mark Tucker. Okay. We're talking about introduction of sensitive electronic equipment now, GFIs, computers, TVs, sound systems, clamp-on, you know, equipment with the surge, and when it's introduced and when do you have it. Go ahead and pick up.
What, Mark? You mentioned that in 18 years, it's evolved. Your product has evolved. So I assume the whole industry has evolved.
Yes.
And I know that UL is involved. Is your product UL listed?
Absolutely, it is,
and
yes.
So UL has evolved their standards in 2000. They have a new standard that came out. If somebody had a surge protection, let's say installed 10 years ago, 15 years ago, I mean, we're going to get into installing them. You really want to put them in your house. But, I mean, since we're there about the product is changing, is that a concern to somebody? Because it was done years ago, and now the product is in there today?
Okay, there's a third revision is what they call it now that just occurred in UL. But if you had second revision UL, the biggest difference, of course, is all your safety features that the products. That's what UL's about.
Let me explain about that. That was in 2000 when the second edition came out.
Right.
So prior to 2000, and we talked about that last week, when you open a neutral, voltages kind of change. Mm-hmm. Surge protectors actually caught on fire because they're supposed to clamp at over 120 volts, right? Remember the situation you had? What was the voltage of one line to neutral when you called me the other day?
167 volts.
167 volts. In that particular example, if you had surge protection,
which you had an old one.
Okay, it would have caught on fire.
Yes. Wow.
And so the UL standard in 2000 changed it to require that there be protection against that case. Because when it goes over voltage, which is what surge protection is supposed to do, mm-hmm. when you open the neutral, the over voltage stayed there. Okay, so now what's the third revision? So if you had surge protection prior to 2000, then I would strongly, as an electrical expert and safety person here, tell you, you need to have it replaced. Now, how can somebody know if they have a second edition or not?
It'll be on the back of the product or on the UL label itself on any product in the marketplace.
All right, so Michael, as you do an electrical contractor and you're visiting people, you know, we're learning here with Mark that we need to check that surge that they have. If it doesn't say Mark second or third edition, then there's a safety hazard.
But see, a lot of these surge protectors that are installed on the properties that we visit, you can't really see anything. It's all been sun damage, and they're little, tiny little guys, and you can't. There's no markings.
Well, then you know what? If it was done before 2000,
yeah,
then for sure you know that it's a dangerous product.
So those products that are existing right now can ignite and catch on fire.
Yeah, they can.
Overvoltage.
There can be a situation.
Yes.
Yes, it can be. And edition number three?
No, but the biggest thing that happened in UL edition number three is everything is thermally protected. What that means in simple, is there's thermal fusing. Temperature rises over 125 degrees centigrade, the surge protector is shut down.
Oh, so you're saying that if
no more fire.
You're saying, wow. So we had fuse protection, which was great, mm-hmm. but the problem was that you could still have heat that was exceeding before the fuse opened.
Correct.
And now, Michael, I don't think you remember this, but I had some photos. We had surge protection on my well motor at my Lake Emma property, and it had actually melted, and it completely disintegrated and fell on the ground. Are you saying, Mark, that the third edition would prevent something like that?
Yes, that's right.
That's where that problem in there.
Yeah. So if these things, you know, melt and smolder and crackle apart, you also have electrical wiring energized now that it could be exposed,
and it could
right?
be exposed, yeah.
120, no, actually 240 volts, because those have a line to line.
Hey, Michael, I think we got a young lady, Gail, on the phone.
Oh, good afternoon, Gail.
Well, I'm not a young lady, but...
We're sorry. Good afternoon.
That's okay. I've been in this business 40 years, and people always say to me about lightning protection. I says, there truly is no direct strike lightning protection.
Oh, you're absolutely right. True. Whatever it strikes, that's toast. That's a potato chip.
It hits it hits the house, you're toast.
Yes.
Yeah. You're gone. I've seen too much equipment over the years. I was with a Motorola for years ago, and we used to go out, and it looked like there was hair growing inside. It just zaps. The lightning protection goes right through everything.
Yep. Gail, you bring out a great point. And we're going to be having this discussion next week, Michael. Insight Lightning Protection is going to be here talking about that.
Perfect.
And Gail, the important thing that you bring out is that if you don't have a lightning protection system and lightning strikes your premises, you can forget about everything. It's going to do whatever it's going to do. Any other comments you want to make, Gail?
Yes. I had a customer down here. I do computers. And he had the suppressor the electric company sent out to him. He had everything plugged into it. He got struck by lightning, not a direct hit, but he got hit by lightning. It took out his computer. It took out his stereo. It took out his TV. It took everything. And they wanted him to send that suppression device in so they could check it. They sent him a new one and said, no, there was nothing wrong with his old one, that nothing happened. I disagree with him. I've seen this too many times. You can't lose six pieces of equipment and then not have come through the power. I don't care what they said about their strip. It just could not happen.
Okay, so now we're talking about, was all this stuff plugged into a power strip? Or
yes.
It was a power strip that comes in, cable out, satellite inside, kind of like with all the different receptacles.
Right. The computer and was all in.
You know, I'm honestly, Gail, I'm with you on that, but I'm not an expert. So, Mark, I know we had this conversation. I mean, if a guy has a failed equipment and you know, you're saying your product is, you know, I don't know if everybody says the same thing. Well, we give an insurance policy on that. And I really question, and I'm not only you, but I question anybody who says they have insurance policy, because my experience is like, you're never going to meet the requirements on that. So if somebody has a power strip and they lose a bunch of pieces of equipment and they say, well, send it back. I mean, like, how is this all going to work out? Are you guys all, as an industry, we didn't have a problem.
When you send it back to us, the first thing we're going to do is test it, and we're going to be able to tell you whether it came in on the phone, the cable, or the power. If it came by one of those, it will have self-sacrifice. There's no choice if it came by that protector. Number one, I'll send you a new protector at no charge. Then we bypass the contractor and go directly with the homeowner and get a claim into process. But there has to be a self-sacrifice part of that surge protector. Otherwise, it came in some other avenue.
You're right. But in this case, knowing what I know, there's no other avenue for it to have come in. And they said when they got the strip, they said it didn't come through the strip.
I understand.
I personally, I don't know the company was. I can't tell you. I have no idea.
I understand.
All I can say is I don't believe them. And I would never, ever send anybody strip in without getting an independent inspection of it.
Anymore. Good point. I understand what you're saying.
I have enough technical people. I can get a very qualified inspection of it.
Well, you're a unique person. So anything else, Gail?
But I recommend everybody here in Florida, everybody get protection. And also on computers, UPS, the uninterrupted power supplies is just critical down here.
Now, Gail, let me ask you a question. Are you in business for yourself, or you work for somebody? What is it that you do?
Now I'm kind of semi-retired from it. I help people out.
Okay, all right. So you're not saying this because you're trying to derive any kind of business or anything like that. You're just saying this because...
No. No. I just, people tell me this, and I tell them, if you had a UPS unit, that would help. And like you say, sacrifice something. I've seen UPS units be sacrificed.
Gotcha.
That's a cheap thing to be sacrificed compared to your computer, you know, and everything.
That's right.
All right, Gail, man, I'll tell you what. I think you did a better job than at least two of us in here. I'm not quite sure the two. Anything else, Gail, you want to tell? Anything else you can tell consumers out there that they, because you're the expert also, because you've seen it for years. Anything else that you can say as an independent person? Because obviously Michael here with Premier Power is here to provide a service to install the surge protection. But, you know, people are going to think, I think you just kind of, you know, you're trying to just get business from me.
Here in Florida, I find it worse than anywhere I've ever lived. And you can put a meter on the line. You can't see it analog. You've got to have a scope to see these spikes coming in. And I see this. I sit with mine turned on sometimes. And I even hear it in my UPS unit go home. And I go, wow. It's happening. And if you can have a blue sky above your head, but it can be, you know, 20 miles down the road where the lightning storm's at.
Good point.
Yep.
Hey, Gail, thank you so much. You're probably the best phone call we've ever had come in.
Thanks, Gail.
Well, thank you.
All right, listen, next week, by the way, we're covering lightning protection. And the week after that, I forgot what I'm going to be covering. But I'm covering another important topic. I'll have to think about that before we go. All right. All right.
Let's talk about the difference between those little portable taps that they have, the strips.
Well, you know, before
with
we go
there, surge.
Let me talk about a system.
Okay.
Okay. I'm sure Gail, if he was listening, or is he still listening, he would probably agree with me. What you really need is a system to protect your equipment. You need surge protection at the electrical service. That's the main power coming in. Then you want to put surge protection at the panels, because the surge devices are designed to be installed at the service, which is the main panel. And what they do is they have different capacities to handle a certain amount of energy. And then you're going to put it at the panel, your electrical panel, which kind of clamps it down a little lower, and it absorbs more energy and it bypasses it. And then you want to, at point of use, at the equipment, you want to get a power strip. And we can't forget about this, son. And that is that your telephone, your cable, and your satellite, because all of this has different sources of energy coming in, and they have a tendency to go together. So you have a surround sound system with your telephone, your cable, your satellite, and electrical power. There's four different paths that energy can enter that equipment. So every single way that energy can enter your building, your telephone, your satellite, your cable, and your power at their source, you need surge protection, and they make different types of devices, obviously for the telephone, the cable, and the satellite. I'm building a house right now, and I had my house built before. I make sure I have surge protection completely in everything. It's making sure I have it. And then at the point of use, you plug in the telephone, telephone in, telephone out, cable in, cable out, satellite in, satellite out, all your electronic equipment, and you know what, son? It doesn't mean you're not going to wipe out your equipment. So that's a system, and that's why you got to get somebody who has the knowledge, like yourself, and the products. You work with SICOM. They've educated you so that you understand how the products get used. We had problems at our office. We put a this was a huge
right.
surge protection device we got from SICOM.
Right.
It was a three-phase 128 volt system that we put on our service because I have lots of equipment in my office. I mean, we're talking tens of thousands of dollars of computers and backup systems. What I don't want to do is think I can save a few dollars. Now, surge protection is not free. You know, obviously it costs some money, but it saves you in the long run, as Gail was mentioning, and that is that in Florida, in Lake County, in this area here, because of it, we really, really, really need it. You were going to say something else, son? Was there anything?
The difference between the little strips inside the house and the ones on the hardwired device as opposed to the plug-in surge protectors. People have those by their TVs, by their systems. Want to spend a couple minutes on that?
One second. That was what I was saying. That's your system.
Oh,
you don't want to buy a power strip and put it by your TV.
Sure,
that
sure.
works. But the problem is the energy wasn't able to be absorbed and absorbed and absorbed. You went right to the equipment, and it's that little device isn't going to protect it. You need to have a system surge at the service, at the panel, at the equipment, and it still doesn't mean you're not going to wipe it out.
Right.
But it means that you're going to have the best chance. So going out and going to Office Depot or Staples or something like that, getting a strip, stick it in there, hey, that's better than nothing.
Right. Right, right.
But you didn't do this. You didn't do it at the cable coming in. You didn't do it at the telephone coming in. You didn't do it at the satellite coming in. You didn't do it at the power coming in. Now, you install surge protection, but most people that you sell surge protection, tell us your experience with it.
We have, you know, complete systems available, and primarily we've only installed the ones for electrical power on the panel, on the outside service, and inside the house panel. That's really it. And they have the little ones that they plug in already from themselves, but generally people...
And you tell them about it. Hey,
we educate them. You really need a whole thing all together because you have all these electrical power utilities coming in on your phone, on your cable, on your power. They're all come in tied together. You know, surge can be, you know, jumped on those cables.
The studies have shown that most damaged equipment is not on power.
No, it's on the lower ends, the little phones, the cable, because they're not protected, they're unshielded, you know, that sort of thing. We're coming to a close here. Mark, I want to thank you for the time to come on the show.
Thank you much, and glad to help you out. Call anytime.
You got it, Dad. Thank you very much.
And listen, next week is going to be lightning, and I still can't figure out what the week after that is going to be.
All right, everybody. Have a great day.